Welcome to the 12th Crocodile Trophy, an event organised by former professional road cyclist Gerhard Schoenbacher. In 2006, this race started from Townsville and finished in Cow Bay, approximately 120 kilometres north of Cairns. 42 cyclists are here from 14 different nationalities to experience the thrill of extreme sport and adventure racing.
The difference with last year and the year before is that before I was a professional cyclist and now I had a desk job for the last year, so that's a bit different. I've been training for a few weeks, but I'm nowhere near the form that I had last year, so we'll see.
The Crocodile Trophy traditionally takes place in late October in far north Queensland. It gives the Europeans the chance to start over their new season. The first stage started in Townsville, around 350 kilometres south of the city of Cairns. Covering a course of 5 kilometres was the objective, 3 laps in total, on the beach in Rose Bay. This was more or less a warm-up, and 15 kilometres sounds easy, but if it isn't for the sinking wheels, it's the wet sand that makes riding extremely hard. To push and push hard, it's the only solution for some of these riders. From the coast to the outback, day two, and the convoy of the Crocodile Trophy moves inland. Regina Stunger is one of the organisers. She says there are 15 support vehicles, 3 trucks altogether, 35 people, as staff, 2 doctors, mechanics, chefs, depots. It really is a large logistic effort. There is a hold-up before stage two. The Crocodile Trophy starts on Harvey's Range, a large military training centre, and an army truck needs space to move through the riders. This is race director Heinz Sieder from Austria. He gives the starting signal. 103 kilometres is what's required for the riders, and traditionally the sun is shining in far north Queensland at this time of the year, but the skies are grey and temperatures, surprisingly, are down to just 22 degrees Celsius. It makes cycling much more enjoyable. After a few kilometres, the sand and gravel begins. From the start, some of the favourites are speeding things up and forming a leading group. They include Danish rider Michael Borup, the Belgian Stevens, and the Austrian Heinz Zorweg. After every 35 kilometres, the riders get their drinks from the official depot. Heinz Zorweg is number one. And of course you have the Hungarian rider, Attila Marton. They shake off the rest of the group. Marton, in fact, is the first Hungarian ever to ride in the trophy. And both cross the line together in Hidden Valley. It's a small place with romantic cabins and a small shop and restaurant with a bar, a perfect place to relax for the riders. As for the crew and the riders themselves, they sleep in tents during the entire Crocodile Trophy. All the accolades go to Austrian chef Gunther, who spoils the participants daily with a large buffet.
It's quite interesting. The guy was washing his bike over there before and had an American accent, and I was expecting all European, so it just seems to be any countries here. It's great.
From Hidden Valley to Le Mans Lagoon, stage three is 156 kilometres long. An early breakaway is formed. It's Austrian Stefan Rucker. Behind him is a group of four with Zorweg, Stevens, Zeller and Borup of Denmark all chasing. The Austrian Stefan Rucker rides a lonely race with a comfortable lead. He lost a lot of time with a mechanical problem during the second stage after taking a wrong turn. Rucker is eventually caught by the chasing group, and together they pass Mount Fox, an old volcano. The tandem team consists of Fred and Francesco from the Netherlands. Now, several tandem teams have previously tried to finish the Crocodile Trophy, but no team has ever made it before.
Good foot, good length. And nice kangaroos along the way.
Fred and Francesco are always in a good mood and always ready for a joke. The weather, the race, the food, and yes, even the kangaroos are all roadside.
A buffet?
Closer to the finish, the race gets faster and faster. Stefan Rocker attacked again and outdistanced the others. He's asking about the situation in the race behind him. Rocker has more than a 5-minute lead. But then disaster. Apart from a crooked saddle and some abrasion, nothing happened, and he was far ahead from the others. Another crash. This time it's Michael Borup. The Dane takes second place with a full-on sprint.
Heinz, denkst du nichts, dass du gestürzt bist?
Stefan Rucker isn't too worried. He says to Heinz, I fell off my bike too, and laughs. As difficult as it might be during the day for the riders, the evenings are picture perfect in far north Queensland as the sun goes down. Spectators in this part of the world are more than rare, but the outback offers lots of cows and kangaroos. It makes a nice change. The rather flat stages on quite hard ground makes for good riding for Rucker. He's a road cyclist. He loves the high speed.
A minute and a half?
They're going slow. Put the hammer down, right?
They're not chasing anymore?
Rucker loves the lead and makes a solo breakaway. Maybe he sees a small chance to recover his lost time on the second stage. The message from the race director is 1 minute and 30 seconds. That's the lead he has on the others. Stefan Rucker rides away. He rides away for the Austrian Pro Continental team and takes stage three. He says he was very satisfied with the performance today. Last year he rode in the team together with 2-time winner Adam Hansen. He says he worked very hard for him that year, but this year he can take his own chances and is in very good shape. As we look at the leaderboard, Heinz Zorweg has a commanding lead over Chris Stevens after stage four. Michael Borup is in third place. This is Goshen Station and its beautiful surroundings on the Herbert River. The waterfalls are pretty, and this was a setting for the TV reality show called Survivor. Around 300 people stayed here for more than 3 months back then.
This one here is very common in these areas, which we call sort of a more transitional forest or open sclerophyll forest. It's called the golden orb. It's fairly harmless. It might look fairly scary. If we look up close, we can check out its fangs. There he is. Look at that. See the fangs there? Beautiful animals, aren't they?
John Flynn knows all about nature. He's been on this bike race more than once. Stage 5. 85 tough kilometres ahead for the participants. The powerline track with numerous small and steep climbs and dangerous downhill sections is what's in store. This track was impassable some weeks before a cyclone destroyed the whole area. The track was reopened just in time for the Croc riders. Most of the sandy sections and steep climbs are impossible to ride, and riders have to get off their bikes. Rivers sometimes are more difficult to cross as they look. It's never easy on the Crocodile Trophy. But this is what makes it such a unique event. It's easier if you have a four-wheel drive. But even the four-wheel drives can have their problems. Unfortunately, Zorweg and Borup followed the camera car. Two riders are back on track. Meanwhile, John Flynn tries his luck with the four-wheel drive.
What do we do now? Well, we have to try and dig this out by hand because unfortunately we don't have a shovel with us or any recovery gear or a winch. So it's a case of dig it out by hand, try and get some traction on the wheel so we can get ourselves out. But to be frank, it's hopeless. We're in a situation we're going to have to wait for someone else to come and get us. So all part of the fun of the Crocodile Trophy.
No fun at all.
Yesterday I was really frustrated and didn't really know what to do, but I mean, there's no point in quitting. I'm just going to, there's other objectives in the race. I will go for stage victories and maybe, I don't know, the point jersey or there's lots of things still and maybe the other guys can get unlucky too and well, maybe I can move up again. So we'll see.
Zorweg drops out. Borup takes it calmly and stays in. Stage 6, Kumbulumba Dam to Urban Bank. It's one of the easiest stages this year. And after 5 days of hard racing in remote areas, the riders finally make it to the small town of Ravenshoe. It's a small town with all the luxuries. When you've been out back for as many days as these riders, civilization is a wonderful sight to see. One of only a couple of female riders in the Crocodile Trophy is Dominique Angerer of Austria. She says she doesn't like the flat stages so much and she's not strong enough to keep up with the pace. Meanwhile, Stefan Rucker leads the classification for the most aggressive rider, but it's Michael Borup who takes the victory and gives all the accolades to Stefan.
He's a real strong sportsman and he said you win because you had an accident yesterday. So he's a really great guy, I think.
It's the halfway mark in the Crocodile Trophy, the town of Urban Bank. It's a small town which was once a big mining town. Today, the only gold mine in town is the Urban Bank pub, where riders and locals can meet and socialise.
I think they're probably a little bit crazy, but we really look forward to seeing them every year. But I'm sure they're not going to talk me into joining them.
Four, three, two, one, go!
Stage 7. It's the longest of this year's Crocodile Trophy, 158 kilometres on old trails through the outback of Queensland and along the old railway line from Mount Garnet to Lapa. Some riders take a lot of risk, some too much, like the Belgian Lingia. He says goodbye to the Crocodile Trophy after crashing out.
See my helmet from the crash I made? It's good always to wear a helmet on the bike, otherwise I wouldn't tell the story here now. Always wear the helmet, man.
The Australian doctor on standby is Sarah Keogh from Cairns. She checked his injuries, but the Belgian has been extremely lucky.
Touching the foot? Yeah. Okay. This is all good?
Mm-hmm.
This one? Okay. This one?
The doctor told me it's no fracture, it isn't broken.
Yeah.
So they give me some painkillers and it's still hurting, but I'm gonna try to end this stage to stay in the Crocodile.
He wants to continue no matter what, but his race is eventually run. After the abandonment of Zorweg, the Belgian Stevens wants to prove that the leader's jersey isn't just a gift. And he proves it with an act of daring riding. Stevens is a complete all-rounder. He's the strongest on the flat sections as well as on the hills. But Stefan Rucker makes the impossible possible. He catches Stevens, who rides for the overall classification on the last kilometres, and wins the stage in Chiligo. Stage victory number 3. Hours later, the wounded Belgian Nick Linger crosses the finish line.
It was the most painful ride of my life.
The individual time trial, and the riders drop down from a truck converted into a launching pad. The course is just 15 kilometres long. It's down the road and back to Chiligo. It looks quite easy, but the road trains and the dust makes it much more difficult. The riders give it all on the bitumen and the dust. Michael Borup is the fastest time trialer, but he doesn't like what he sees.
I don't think anybody loves time trials, but some way they're hard to hate also. So, yeah, I was just giving it full gas today.
The weather in week 2 starts to slowly go back to usual Crocodile Trophy weather. That means hot. A jump in a billabong helps riders cool down. On the stage menu today, 136 kilometres from Chiligo to Mount Mulgrave. It's a flat stage, but corrugations and 35 degree temperatures makes it very hard again. But what about the Dutch tandem team? After more than 20 flat tyres, 10 broken chains and a broken front fork during the first week, it's the day of the tandems. These guys can prove that two is better than one.
800 kilometers in my head.
600 to go.
Sorry?
600 to go.
600 to go, holy.
It rarely happens in the Crocodile Trophy. In fact, it's never happened after 12 years of racing. But at last, a tandem team wins for the first time. Maybe it is easier with two. Fred and Francesco, 5 minutes ahead of Darren O'Grady, who's the brother of Australian professional Tour de France rider, Stuart. The riders recover from the hard day's work, cooling their heels, as the chef prepares the steaks.
I've always dreamed about doing this race. I've been doing mountain biking for some years ago, and I've heard about this race from one of my good friends who've done it twice, and it's always been a dream. And now, this was the year there where I should just do it.
Huge applause for the tandem team. No wonder, after their historical victory. And so after 9 stages of toil, it's Christophe Stevens, the Belgian, who has a commanding 25-minute lead from Attila Marton of Hungary and Valentin Zeller in third place. Stage 10, from Mount Mulgrave to Laura. Laura has a significant history. It's where the Quinkan Aborigines tribe live, and they've been here for centuries. It's a very special day for Stefan Rucker. This is the National Day of Austria. But it's also the hottest day of the 2006 Crocodile Trophy. How anybody could make a solo breakaway on the corrugated roads is unimaginable. The heat is stifling. Rucker uses all his energies in this outback country. But after 150 kilometres, he makes it to the finish line on his own. It's his fourth stage win in this trophy. The national flag of Austria is raised on its national day. Stefan Rucker says this will be his last race. He will never return. The Aboriginal culture on display in this area is easier to see. The start to another marathon stage from Lura to Cooktown. It's 142 kilometres of corrugated roads and endless long straight roads. The corrugations makes riding and steering at the same time equally difficult. It's tough today, but not as tough as yesterday's heat. And at the finish line is the Great Barrier Reef. The daily physical exertion that these riders have to go through is taxing. The Austrian rider Valentin Zeller is third in the overall standings, and he is totally exhausted. Nevertheless, he gets back on his bike, but not for long. The Crocodile Trophy is over for Valentin. Riders didn't know it at the time, but Zeller dropped out of the race. The Crocodile Trophy is called such a race for good reason. Although the crocs are rare, they do come out to play. Young Aborigines from Hope Vale visit the Crocodile Trophy to bring home the riders. This is Cooktown. Captain James Cook was the first to set his footprints on Grassy Hill more than 230 years ago. Today, it's Christoph Stevens who dominates the stage. He arrives high above Cooktown on Grassy Hill, ahead of Aussie David Woods. And of course, there's Hungarian Attila Marton. The incredible views pay off for this physical outfit. No one wants to leave Cooktown, its friendly people, and the beautiful ocean views. Christoph Stevens is the stage winner.
Welcome to Cooktown. I mean, that's one of the reasons we came here is because of, you know, the geography and everything and being so far, being different from home, so it'll be fun.
Two more stages to go. The riders leave Cooktown, say goodbye to the historic buildings that were built last century, and head towards a southerly direction. Not that it gets any easier. The peloton has to make its way through Daintree rainforest. But for the last time, the Crocodile Trophy will present the riders everything the race is known for. Rainforest, river crossings, small and steep trails, almost unusable tracks only cleared of fallen trees one day before the race. It's never easy. Japanese Toru Watanabe crosses the finish line.
Oh man, I was yelling my head off just trying to get myself through the finish. I was fully spent. No energy left, no water left, no nothing left. And just pushing myself over the hills. And then as soon as that downhill came, I was ecstatic, just absolutely stoked. And it was sketchy really fast. And yeah, I just let it go and just, yeah, got through the finish. And oh man, I'm absolutely stoked.
A good result also for the Aussie, David Wood. This is the Daintree Rainforest. It's beautiful by day, but you never know what's out there by night. The riders know there's only 2 days of racing left. The last day of the Croc Trophy, it's time to get one's thoughts and explain how you should prepare for a race like this.
Das ist das Schwierigste eigentlich am Leistungssport, dass man genau einen Mittelweg findet.
Stefan Rocker says it's the most difficult part in the competitive sport to find the way between too much and not enough training. He says during a two-week stage race like this, you have to make sure you never exceed your physical limits. You must always check your computer and your latest instruments daily. It shows all the important information. Most important, it shows that you still have hidden reserves. It replaces a trainer and a coach. The experienced 63-year-old Californian former businessman is Carl Burgert. He knows how to spend his energies carefully to finish a hard race over 1,400 kilometres through the bush. And after two steep climbs, the riders finally make it home to Cape Tribulation and Cow Bay on the Great Barrier Reef. It's a real frenzy to make it to the finish line. But after 1,430 kilometres of racing, no matter where you finish, everybody is happy.
Crocodile Trophy is something special. It's I met my wife Anita that 3 years ago, and now I'm winning the thing. So yeah, it takes a big part of my life, and I'm happy to finish my career like this.
This is the toughest race of them all. The overall winner is Christophe Stevens of Belgium. He had a 33-minute and 8-second lead over Attila Marton, with Stefan Rucker in third place. But all these riders are winners. They've made it after starting from Townsville 2 weeks earlier to Cow Bay on the picturesque Great Barrier Reef. The 2007 Croc Trophy starts on October 23. It'll be a shortened 10-stage race, and race director Gerhard Schoenbacher says he'll raise the number of entries to 80. He says he doesn't want any more than that. It's an adventure and one you'll never forget.